Every year, BreastFest has a survivor celebration. It's a time right in the middle of the festival where we get to really celebrate what the festival is all about besides the charitable partners. A key element of that survivor celebration is a survivor speaker, a brave woman who graces the stage from backyards to barns and tells the story of what she's been through. These stories are heart-wrenching. They talk of uncertainty and fear and the impact that this terrible disease has not only on the individual, but on the families and friends of the people who love them. This year, I am honored to do the introduction of this segment because Judy Shoulak, my mother, is busy preparing her speech. On this 10th anniversary of Shoulak BreastFest Music Festivals, I am thrilled to introduce Judy Shoulak, festival co-founder, cancer survivor, and my mother, to share her story with you all.
So throughout the course of our BreastFest history, we've always had a survivor ceremony and had different speakers tell their story. It's always been one of my favorite parts of the whole event because it's really the reason that we're here. Sure, it's easy to get caught up in the items that we're bidding on and the dancing and the reuniting with friends who are usually at BreastFest every year, but we're really here to celebrate our survivors and to be here for the families of those who have not been fortunate enough to be a survivor. So given that it's our 10-year anniversary, it was kind of suggested that maybe this would be a good year for me to tell my story. So here goes. I'll start by saying that cancer was not really in my family. I mean, we have a huge family. 6 kids in my family, my mom had 10 kids. I mean, there's tons of relatives. Cancer has not been prevalent in our family. So it was the last thing on my mind that I would ever have. So the one thing I did have quite frequently though is I would get cysts. And so I hadn't since I was younger, and I would often go to the doctor and I'd have a cyst, and she would always say the same thing to me. She would say, "It's round, it moves, I think it's a cyst, but let's check it out." That's not giving you any kind of diagnostic opinion there, but that's what she just said to me so many times. "It's round, it moves, I think it's a cyst, let's check it out." So I would go and have that checked out. Everything was always fine. I just felt it was actually quite routine. So this one year, it was towards the end of 2010, beginning of 2011. Some of you may have remembered this P90X workout program. So I started doing that. And if you know what it's like when you start working out, you're kind of like, oh, you can feel your muscles are pulled. It feels kind of good. You know you're causing your body some kind of pain and you're doing some good probably. So I was doing that, and I think I had been doing some pull-ups, and after that I was just kind of feeling my muscles and feeling, wow, this like feels really good, I'm doing some good. And then as I was doing that, I could feel right against my chest cavity, I could feel a lump. And it was different than anything I had felt before, and I believe I said out loud to myself, "It's not round, it's not moving, and I'm gonna check this out." So that was the beginning of my breast cancer journey. It was shortly before my birthday, and I remember that I had the tests taken, and then I flew off to Denver to spend time with my daughter, Sarah. And I didn't tell her anything about the test because I really didn't want her to worry. And I just wanted to enjoy the weekend, which I did. So I came back to work on Monday, I believe, and then Tuesday of that week, we would have full day leadership team meetings at Buffalo Wild Wings. And at that time, I led all of the operations for all of the 1,200 restaurants in the company, so pretty significant job. And I was sitting in the leadership team meeting and I saw my doctor's phone number pop up, and Some of you can probably relate to this, that just nervousness when you see your doctor's office number pop up. I mean, it's still, I have the same doctor still, and the same number still pops up. It still makes me nervous, no matter, even if I'm not waiting for a test result. In any event, the number popped out. I walked out of the meeting. I still remember going into the small office, and it was the nurse, and she said those painful words, "You have cancer." And I just immediately started crying. Then I called my husband. Then I went into my office. I went downstairs and to try to contain myself before going back into this meeting. So I told my administrative assistant, Carol Meyer, who was sitting outside my office, came inside my office, cried some more, called my brother Daniel, told him, and then I regrouped and I went back into that meeting. And I spent the rest of the day there. And my biggest challenge at that point was, how am I going to tell my children? You know, now I had spent the weekend with my daughter, now I was gonna have to call her and tell her instead of telling her in person. My two sons were living with us or pretty close here on our property. So I remember telling each and every one of them, and I just remember wanting them to feel like I was okay. I didn't want, it's just a mom thing. I didn't want them to worry about me. So I just really played it off like, don't worry about it. I'm sure we cut it early, let's not worry. I'm sure I'm gonna be fine. So that's how I was at home. And then I'd go off to work in this big job where I didn't want people to think I couldn't do my job because I had some type of cancer, so I would there pretend like everything was fine. And I think for the first 10 days, I cried to and from work every single day. I was so scared. I had no idea what this meant. Was I didn't know how serious it was. I didn't know what my treatment would be. I just thought anyone with cancer died. That was just my impression. So in any event, I really was lucky because I really did catch things early. And I mean, by just having done that workout, I am so grateful. But I was able to catch it really early. I was actually officially stage two because there was a little trace of it was in my lymph nodes. But I remember my doctor had recommended that I would go through chemotherapy. I think she said maybe 6 weeks. And you know, I had heard a lot about the damage that chemotherapy does, and some people had warned me, some of our franchisees at Buffalo Wild Wings, one gentleman in particular, he's like, make sure you just really do the appropriate amount of treatment. Don't overdo it, don't do less. And you know, you're kind of overwhelmed with all this information about a topic that's so critical to your life, and you really are just getting all this like a fire hose. In any event, I basically talked to my doctor about it. I remember my husband Jim and I were talking to the doctor at the same time and asking, like, how do you determine? She said, if you definitely would base your opinion maybe differently, because some people are like, I'm doing the maximum treatment. Some people are like, I'm doing the minimal. But if it would make a difference, we can send your actual tumor out and find out how aggressive it is. So long story short, when that tumor came back, it was not the most aggressive type. And basically she told us that I would have the same chance of it coming back with or without chemotherapy. So I decided not to do chemotherapy. I decided just to do radiation. And then I probably thought about that many times after. Did I do the right thing? Should I have done more treatment? But as things are now, almost 10 years down the road, I feel really comfortable that I did do the right thing for myself. And it's one of my suggestions that I have is you have to make a decision, try to make the best decision that you can, and then move on from there. So anyways, I had my treatment. I really never missed a day of work. I would go to radiation every day in the morning, then I would go to work, and then I would come home and lay down. I was exhausted, but that was my treatment, was radiation. And I guess I do have three takeaways that I would share with people from what I learned through my experience would be, number one, make sure you're taking care of yourself. Your immune system is super important. I don't know what I was thinking. I lived on minimal sleep for years. I'm sure I didn't have any type of immune system. So since then, I am super conscientious of making sure that I get enough sleep, that I'm exercising, that I'm taking care of myself. But that was a huge learning. And the other thing is, don't put things off that you can do. I would say that I was always have been a very grateful and appreciative person. However, I did put things off. I thought I had forever. I was superwoman. I had the rest of my life to do whatever I wanted to. So, you know, after having breast cancer, I went to Hawaii, I went to Paris, I went to Alaska, and we went to Norway, which we are gonna do on our 25th anniversary, but we did it on our 30th. But who knows if I would have done that if I hadn't had breast cancer. So it's really important to not put things off. And then something else that I think we all say when something bad happens, but we just don't always live that way, is just enjoy every day. It's not a given. I mean, they say the present is a gift, but it's not a guarantee that you're gonna have tomorrow or next week or next year. So you wanna make sure that you're just enjoying every single day. And I'm so grateful for every day. I mean, everyone in my family knows that every morning I talk about what I'm grateful for and what I'm looking forward to. And I probably say that a million times to my kids. You know, what are you grateful for and what are you looking forward to? So those are just a couple things that are really important to me. And, you know, then came BreastFest. I'm sure it's somewhere in the control department that those of us like to control things, that when we're put in a situation where we really can't control things, that our being able to help the whole situation in its entirety going forward, we try to do something to help control the issue, even if we haven't been able to completely control what happened to us. So I'm so thrilled that my family, my extended family, my Wisconsin family and relatives have been so involved in this event year after year, getting auction items, selling raffle tickets, doing everything. And it's just been amazing. I love all of you. I'm so thankful to tell you my little breast cancer story, which was the beginning of BreastFest. And again, thank you for listening. Thank you for being here. And here's to another 10 years. I'm looking forward to seeing you and speaking again on our 20th anniversary. 20 years, I'll see you there.
I know I've heard that story a million times, but understandably, it always hits home. But you know, if you've been to our festival, that we're here to dance, and that is a huge part of the Survivor Celebration as well. Huh? See? We dancing. If you are having your own virtual BreastFest here along with us, please remember to take pictures of it and share with the hashtag SHOUBF on social media so we can find you and celebrate along with you. What? I'm sorry? Oh, wow. I am so sorry for the interruption, but I just got word that someone very special would like to say a few words.
Hi, this is Gloria Gaynor. Help Judy and me kick off the Shoulak BreastFest 10th fundraiser against breast cancer. We want you to sing, we want you to dance your heart out. At first I was afraid, I was petrified, kept thinking I could never live without you by my side. You get the idea. Take it away, Judy.